Here we go.
All right. So I'm going to start this off too. This is just to make sure that we don't miss a beat. You look beautiful. I actually like you very much in purple. I have to tell you, I like you very much in purple. So I'm going to tell you what we're going to focus on. The interview is going to be in like three different parts. Your childhood growing up in Montgomery, Alabama. Your family life. And then moving to Norway. We'll talk a little bit about civil rights as well, because the first thing that pops into my head when you told me that you were born in Montgomery, Alabama, was it was like the birthplace of the civil rights movement. And an awful lot happened there when you were in your teens. So let's introduce you first. Annette Atkins. And where were you born, Annette?
I was born in Montgomery, Alabama.
Okay.
In January 5th, 1944. And my childhood was, my mother was, I was born when my mother was 17. And she was married to my father. But she I had a stepdad. And then, so then I had five sisters, brothers. And on my dad's side, I was 17 of us.
17?
Yeah, so I got six sisters living and six sisters. On my dad's side, I got six sisters and six brothers living. And my mother's side, I have three, four sisters and two brothers. And with me, you know, and so anyway, I was born, and as I say, I had a childhood. It was a normal childhood growing up. We was poor, but wasn't, my mother, my grandmother, she worked. My mother, most of my grandmother raised me, and she worked for the, some rich white people down in Alabama. So.
And you were born in 1944, mm-hmm. Is that right?
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So.
I went to Booker T. Washington School.
Okay. Booker T. Washington School.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And your mother worked. Did your father work also?
My father worked. My mother worked for a little bit, but.
And we're talking about your stepfather here?
My stepfather.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And my mother grew up, I mean, you know, she grew up, like I said, she had me when she was 17. Then she continued to have children after she got married. But then she was like, she began to turn to, you know, an alcoholic. We didn't know what alcoholic was, but again, you know, just drink, you know. So, one thing, and I remember being bad at alcohol when I came up here in 68. I came up here in 67, and I found out about alcoholism.
So you thought that her drinking was just a way of life?
Well, drinking, that was like what really killed her. You know, she had herself seizures. And in 1975, she had a seizure. And didn't nobody know what to do with me at home. And she had friends over. I was up here, and they said she had a seizure. And then she, they left her there. And when they found her, my sister found her, she was dead.
And how old was she when she died?
I think my mother was in her 40s, late 40s.
Young woman.
Young.
Yeah. So, was your stepfather still alive when she died?
My stepfather, yes, he was alive. And he was at his girlfriend's house. And that's the reason today, you know, I still have a hang up about, you know, not trusting men to pay the rent to, I've been married three times. I got married when I dropped out. I got pregnant when I was 16. And I got married to my first husband, which was a good husband. I got married again when I was 24. And I was up here, and I lived in New York, in the Bronx. Then I got married when I was 50. And that's the one that shot me and killed my son. Maybe I'm hopping, skipping and jumping, but this way.
I'll keep this on track.
And so, and my, And so that, you know, by my mother, my stepfather, he was a father, he was a good dad, but sometimes he didn't come home, he'd go to the girlfriend house. And when he went to the girlfriend house, they had to keep it hid from us, you know. And we'd be all looking nice on Friday evening, wait for him to bring the check in. And he had his own business, you know. It was Wrigley. Yeah. And so.
So did your mother know that her husband was cheating on
her? Yeah, she knew. I can think that's what drove her to start drinking. But we never talk about it. And so she would be waiting on him, and then he didn't come home until probably Saturday night or Sunday morning. But he didn't have the money. But it was like, you know, by me being the oldest of my sisters and brothers, you know, on my mother's side, not the one that my real father had, but their father, I just didn't trust them, man. And so, and when I grew up, to always wanted to work, even though none of them tell me not to work, I had to go and have the bills. And to this day, I would have to have the bills paid fully.
Yeah.
You always have to have some money.
Yeah.
I didn't know I never wanted an excellent man for me.
Yeah. Now, your first husband, when you were 16, and this, what happened there? Did he die? Did you have children?
I have three children. It's my oldest son, Anthony. He did 24 years in the Navy, and he worked for the Navy now. He's in Virginia Beach.
Okay.
He and Mary were two kids.
Okay.
And he's a good son. And I have another girl.
So which your first husband?
My first husband. Then I have a son that's deceased. He died in 2009.
This is the son we'll talk towards the end of the interview.
No, this is not the one that's 24.
Okay.
This is the one that's 44.
Okay.
He died in 2009.
How did he die?
To lung cancer, smoke.
And how old is he?
44.
Very, very young.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very young. Let's go back a little bit to Montgomery and Ben. We'll come back to all of the family stuff too. Because you have lived a very interesting life.
Mm-hmm.
Said it, so hopefully we'll all learn something from it.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about Montgomery and Ben. You were born in 1944.
Mm-hmm.
And I was reading that Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat on the bus in Montgomery, Alabama.
Yeah.
When you were 11 years old, in
mm-hmm.
1955.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember that? Because it's considered like the beginning of the civil rights movement.
Yeah, I remember that.
And what did that mean to an 11-year-old?
11-year-old, it meant to me that because my grandmother, she couldn't catch old Park bus. She had to walk to work, to Rosemont Barron.
Because black people weren't allowed to take
transportation. Sometimes the lady would bring her home at night,
yeah.
But she worked from 7 to 7 in the morning.
Yeah, but who did she work for, do you remember?
The Bears.
And what did she do for them?
She was a maid.
She was a maid.
Mm-hmm.
She was a maid.
And
was that a typical job for women, black women in Montgomery, Alabama?
Yes, yes. And I have aunt that was some men that still work for the daughters. Your daughter.
Wow.
She's, your daughter should be 60, and my aunt is 82, her 83, and she's still ironing for them on Tuesday.
She irons for them on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How were they to work for? It sounds like they were nice. If they drove from home, I mean, were they a nice family?
They was a nice family, yes. I worked for them too. I babysit.
Yeah.
And then I also would go and help my grandmother, you know, I would sit up on the stool and iron.
Yeah.
And when that time you have to iron Mr. Bear's shorts and the sheets, the white sheets and stuff, while she'd be cleaning and making dinner.
Yeah.
And had to iron, you know, I'd sit up on the stool.
Yeah.
And then I would iron, you know, the sheets and stuff. My grandmother would fold them out.
And how old were you when you were doing the ironing?
I was about 11 or 12.
Okay. So going back then, you were 11 or 12 when Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat in the bus.
Mm-hmm.
How did the black
whole big freedom march. It was a whole mess, you know. And they marched from Selma, Alabama, to Montgomery, Alabama.
Yeah.
And down Dexter Avenue, which had a church down on Dexter Avenue.
And the church was where? On Esther Avenue?
No, Dexter.
Dexter, sorry, I have an accent. I have bad ears.
So
we all have an accent.
Yeah. And so Dexter Avenue, that was where the Capitol is.
Okay.
And Martin Luther King had a church there.
Right.
That's over Dexter Avenue.
Okay, Esther Avenue.
Plus he had a son, his first son was named Dexter.
Okay. Okay.
Martin Luther King.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they marched up to the Capitol. So I had sisters, stepsisters that was old enough to get in there pretty much, but I was sitting on the side and watch because, you know, I was supposed to be there because I was so small. I mean, I was young and I was watching, you know, the police and the white, you know, the families keep the hose pipe and they beat you with whips and everything.
And but did you see some of this happening?
I saw some of them. I was getting to no bothers. And then they kept singing, you know, "We're gonna let," and Governor Wallace, he was the governor.
What were they singing?
"We ain't gonna let Governor Wallace turn us around."
"We ain't gonna let Governor Wallace turn us around."
Yeah, the song.
You remember that?
Yeah, the song.
How did it go? Do you remember?
Yeah, it was like, "We ain't gonna let Governor Wallace turn us around, turn us around, turn us around. We ain't gonna let Governor Wallace turn us around. And I'm gonna keep on marching, keep on walking. Walking up the freedom way."
Wow.
And wow. And it was still beating them, and it was beating them. Blood was running, and the hose, you know, the fire hose, they got so much force to it till they would just rip your skin apart.
Wow. And at 11 year old watching that, were you scared?
I really was. I was afraid, but I wasn't supposed to be there either. But I was watching them because I was down there, you know, my sister was there, and I was afraid for them. And because they wasn't supposed to fight back, you know.
Did you see anybody getting hurt?
Oh, yeah, there's dragons, so it was terrible. And then I can't remember how I got home or what, but I know I got home.
So when you went to school, of course, the schools were all segregated, and that's one school and the white
one
together.
Mm-hmm.
And you just mentioned that your grandmother couldn't take public transportation.
No, then
did you have any white friends at all?
No.
Just the whites that next to me?
No.
No.
You went to a movie, the white sit downstairs, the black sit upstairs.
Mm-hmm. Were you ever treated poorly by whites when you were a kid?
Well, no, because they didn't mix.
It just didn't mix.
And I never did understand it to this day. I say, my grandmother, they was, you know, the people that she worked for, they was real nice. But to this day, I don't understand because she had, Miss Bear had Mary Todd. And I wore my Mary Todd clothes, and it was rich enough.
Mary Tyler, is that a label?
No, Mary Tart. Her name was Mary Tart.
Mary Tart.
That was her name.
Okay.
So, the lady she worked for, my grandmother worked for, she would give me her clothes.
Okay.
So I fitted the oldest daughter clothes.
So you had nice clothes?
Yes. And so my sister Cynthia,
she
fitted Evelyn clothes.
Right.
So my sister Jackie, she fitted, Carolyn would go.
Right.
So then my brother Michael, he fitted Joe Beckles.
So you all got the
So we were all dressed.
Okay.
So the black kids used to keep tease us about, we don't wear no white kids, no white children clothes, you know, like that.
So you got, they were teasing you about dressing like whites?
Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
So the black, I got teased a lot about the black. I mean, back from the black.
Yeah.
And I will also fight.
So, how far away did you live from school? And you, of course, then you went to walk, right?
Yeah, we had walks. It wasn't that far away, because we walked in groups.
Yeah.
And it was cold down here then.
Yeah.
So, it rained. they put transportation, and we got a cab and it was me.
So we're going to go back now to your first husband when you were 16. And what was your first husband's name?
Winston Ashley.
What was your last name?
Ashley, A-S-H-L-E-Y.
Ashley. Mm-hmm. And you were 16?
And he was 21.
He was 21. So you fell in love. I
didn't fall in love. I was my grandfather and my grandmother. They always went up the best for me because I was in the 10th grade and I was played basketball, I played softball, I ran track, I ran all that, and then I was just like tomboyish, like, and I wouldn't think about boys, but you know, he came from Cincinnati, Ohio. And he was fine, good looking, everything. But that still didn't bother me because I went into being a boy as he wanted. But he could have had any girl he wanted, all the light skin, because the guys, all the black men was into light skin people. So I was on light skin, so I didn't even care. So I just wanted to run track, I wanted to play softball with the lights at night, and I wanted to play basketball and all like that, and run track. So I was, you know, listen to that.
Yeah.
So it happened, I just, you know, he was talking to me one time and then he didn't even like this. When I would win the games, the guys would always be with me and they would push me up in the air and throw brick soda all over me, you know, or something like was going to win the game. And they would, you know, so he said he thought that I was, he didn't know I was a virgin until I slipped out one night with him, and then he found out I was a virgin. And then he wanted to marry me. But then I didn't know I had already got pregnant with Anthony and went on a picture with
him. Okay.
So then I didn't want to get married because I wasn't in love. But, you know, I wanted, but I couldn't go back to school either.
Yeah. So you left school and got married because you were pregnant.
Yeah, but I still stayed with my grandmother. I went to Cincinnati, Ohio, and I cried so too, brother, but so I wanted to marry my grandmother.
Is that where he was from, Cincinnati, Ohio?
Yes, but his family was down there. He had a sister in Cincinnati.
Okay. And how long were you married to your 24, was it? How long did you stay married to your first husband?
Well, 5 years I stayed with him.
And you had two children?
Three.
Three children. Okay.
And then...
Oh, this is the 44-year-old that died of cancer.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And you had a daughter as well. What's your daughter now?
She's in Alabama.
She's in Alabama.
Mm-hmm.
And how many children? She married the children too?
No, she had one daughter.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And your other son is in the Navy?
Yeah, two sons.
Okay. And he has two sons.
Yeah, he's married.
Okay. And your second husband, you married when you were 25, is that right?
Yeah, I married him. And I don't know why you tell me why I married him. I went to a movie one night and I saw up here on Wall Street and I saw this movie. I had saw, well, I was working and then I wanted to find a room and I had, had a little baby, Tracy. I don't have a picture of her. But I had, I was working at Style Footwear and then I was working at the bar. So I met this lady that the bar, you know, me was in the kitchen, that cooked. So anyway, I met her, so I was looking for a room. So she said she had a room up in Meadow Garden. So I went up there to look at the room and I missed the picture. And I said, I said, that's your husband? She said, no, it's my brother. So she said, he lived in New York. I said, he was like Ron O'Neill, and I said, playing the Superfly. And that was terrible. So, and I met him, and you know, and he kept coming over there and talking to me, and he was a police officer in New York, and plus he was like the manager of the Apollo Theater and all the theaters on 42nd Street. So it was like, we started dating, and then, so we had planned to get married at Christmas, so when his father got sick down, now I was 25, and he was he was, I didn't find out until I got back from Raleigh to South Carolina.
Yeah.
And he put on the thing that he was 39. So his sister said, how you gonna be 39 and I'm 39? I said, yeah, and there was a 39 and he was 41. But I married him.
Quite a bit older than you.
Yeah, I married him because he was like, Ron O'Neill played Super.
So Ryan O'Neill.
Ron O'Neill.
Ron O'Neill. See, I'm not a sports fan, so.
No, he was in Superfly and he played, you know, he had this pretty wavy hair. He was a black guy, but
yeah,
he
yeah.
realized it. And his hair was hanging all down. And he was so cool that he would, like, smell coke off his cross around his neck. And I thought he was so fine and everything. And then when I saw him, that's who I thought the picture was.
Yeah.
Ron O'Neill, and I saw him, and I was excited. But then after he wanted to talk to me and this and that, and so then he asked me to marry him. And so then his father was sick down in Georgia, South Carolina. We went down there and went down there. So his dad said, you wanted him to marry me before, you know, he died. But his dad lived longer than we stayed together.
So his father outlasted the marriage. Is what
yeah, outlasted the marriage.
Was it a good marriage? Was it fun?
It was fun and everything. It was fun. I mean, he gave me everything I wanted. Everything I wanted, he gave me. But the thing was that he was so good-looking and so fine until men thought he was good-looking. And he was so fine until when I married him, I didn't realize that he had so many men, black, white, Puerto Rican, everything.
Okay.
You name it. But he always gave me respect.
Okay.
And he always dressed sharp and everything. I liked a man to dress. And
yeah,
boom, my first husband, the last one, all of my life, man, kept the stuff up.
Okay.
And so, but he always thought that I needed money. I wanted my husband, man, you know, all the time he would go, and not all the time, but he was, you know, he had his jobs and he was gone. He would put me at the Apollo Theater, me and Tracy, and then he would tell the,
And who's Tracy?
My daughter, Tracy.
Okay.
She's 44 now.
Okay.
42. So she would tell, he would tell them that, you know, in the Apollo Theater, in the theaters back in the 60s and the early 70s, they had the, what you call it, the people that, you know, that could put you out if you back up. And,
yes, the bouncers, the
yeah,
bodyguards.
Bodyguards, you know, in the, back in the Apollo Theater, and they had the James Brown Nene and Martha and the Vandellas, and I would go there and watch them. But they had them, they called them, I can't think of them now, but they would have them watching us, you know, when nobody, you know, it wasn't that bad back then, you know, like
yeah.
it is today.
Yeah.
And so the theater, I could go there and watch the theater and stay there all that and go out, come back and take us out for lunch back. But then, so I wanted my husband, so sometimes he would gamble, he'd say he was gambling. He would go out and he would stay Friday night until Saturday, and then he would come back, and there's $500 or $600, you know, on the bed. Where you been? I was working. But I want my husband at home for me. So, I mean, money, and so then I was going out, yeah, I dressed sharp, and I was, you know, because I was my son and you, and, I wore the high heels, you know, the spike heels, and I dressed nice. I wore the false eyelashes. I had my nails done. I had long hair, like my hair was about like yours, but I would put a fall in it, and I would comb my hair back long, and then I would, you know, have the heels on it, you know, dress real nice.
Yeah.
And he'd go get his hair done, and he had his hair all long and stuff. So, but. And then I had my daughter dressed all cute, so the little hair that I wouldn't put in my hair, I would take it and put it in her hair and make her hair long too, but it would be in braids.
So was it like full hair, fake hair that you braided?
I didn't have it braided. Okay, like this was my hair right here. Like
yeah.
Your hair?
Yeah.
Okay, it was a fall that you can put under there, they call it a fall. And then,
what was it called?
A fall, because it's going to fall back.
A fall.
Fall.
I see. I thought you said it was fake hair.
It was fake hair.
Yeah.
But it was a
fall.
It's going to
fall.
Because it's, okay, you put the hair up on it. It's all everything, the same thing.
Gorgeous.
you put your hair up under your hair in the clips on, so you just comb your hair back like this, and it's going, it's the same thing happening today.
Yes. Yeah,
and it's going, you know, like if you put some fake hair up under your...
The extensions.
The extensions, they're going to fall down like this.
Yep.
And you take your hair and comb it back so it's going to fall in place with the fake hair.
Yeah, yeah.
So, no matter what, you know, yes, you know, it's beautiful. You can take it off, whatever.
So you're gorgeous.
And yeah, I'm gorgeous. You know, I know I'm gorgeous, and I know I was in that eyelash.
You know you're fine.
I know I'm fine. I know I'm teeny. I know I ain't fat. And I know, you know. But, and I would go down to, you know, just gave me $500, $600, and I got my little girl. And then when my other kids was up in South now, because my grandmother, when I went on the sleep-in job, that's how I got up here. Because I didn't want to be married no more. And my grandmother said, try not to have no more kids. She said, truly. She said, because my dad's here to have you take care of them. And my husband, he was going to take care of them too. But because one thing that upset me with the man, and I probably would have stayed with the first husband, he still loved me.
Yeah.
But if I, somebody, you can tell me my husband cheated. Okay, I might, like, I said, okay, I believe, but I don't really believe it because I haven't seen him. But when I say, that's you, and I see it with my own eye, then it's no feeling there no more. Yeah. It's just only, you know, just staying there for the kids' sake. It's not, I don't want him to touch me. I don't want to get in the bed with him. I get in the bed, but I don't want him to touch me because, you know, am I allowed to say this?
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
I don't want him to touch me because, you know, I'm thinking about, oh, well, he told the other woman that, you know, how he don't, you know, that's what I'm thinking in my mind. It could be, he might not be saying that.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking about, well, he's probably making love to her the same way he making love to me, yeah, kissing her the same way. Oh, no, I can't deal with that.
Okay.
So now.
So you're one man, one woman, that's what you want.
That's one man, one woman, that's what it's supposed to be. But it's not like that.
Yeah.
But, you know, some marriages is, I'm going to say every marriage.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
And funny, this way Bible study was last week in church,
yeah,
about fornication and adultery.
Yeah.
And I got up and spoke on that, you know, in our church last week. And I just came from the cemetery, and I spoke on that. Because to say needed somebody to hear that. There wasn't nobody raising their hand. And Bible study started, at 7 o'clock, and I got there at 8 o'clock. And when I got there, the pastor, they was talking about that, and they said, if somebody can raise their hand, because you know you done been through that, and you could help somebody.
Yes,
so
exactly.
I raised my hand, and they said, who is that back there? And they said, Sister Annette. And I raised my hand. And I stood up and I talked about it.
Because as I was saying before we turned the camera on, some of these things we need to talk about, because it's happening.
It's happening.
It's happening.
The young people, you know, they're out there, and they're committing adultery. And they, I mean, some of them married, okay. They married, I go to Holiness Church. I'm skipping, like, you know, I go to Holiness Church. And, you know, church is where the heart is, you know, it's one God, but it's many denominations.
Yeah.
But in the church, you're not supposed to, even if there's no church, you're not supposed to go out there, and that's a sin. You're not supposed to have sex without marriage, but people do.
Yes.
That's called fornication.
Yes.
Adultery is when you're not married, if you're married and then you have sex with another woman or another man, you know, vice versa. You know, that's adultery, you know. And two men or two women going together,
yes,
that's abomination. So that's found in Leviticus 21 chapter, 21 chapter 18 verse.
So you're a religious person, isn't
you? Yes, I am.
Yeah.
So, not that I've been, I haven't fallen down, but I ain't got back up. And God delivered me, you know, out of, I used to be an alcoholic.
Okay.
And God delivered me.
And how long have you been sober?
I've been sober for, let me see, 91.
Since 91,
that's a long time. So I fell out in 84. I guess when I was 82 and I went back out there in 80, in 85.
Yeah.
But
do you worry
your mom died when she was 24, was that always an important thing for you to keep in mind, is alcoholism?
No, it wasn't, because, you know, I said, maybe if I had a knew about alcoholism, maybe I could have helped my mom. But I didn't find out that I got up here. And I didn't find out that I was an alcoholic because I wasn't drinking till my mom passed.
So
in 75, my mom passed.
So how old were you when you started drinking?
I guess I was like, my mom, I think I was about 31, 32. But when my mom passed, and I think you do the calculate, I was, my mom died in 1975. So when I went home to live with my grandmother, not knowing that I had sisters down there, but my grandmother didn't want to go by herself. So I moved back to Connecticut then. So I didn't know my aunt was going to move from Lansing, Michigan. But God always got it perfect. See, and I moved down there, and when I moved down there, my sister never knew a lot of guys on the... in Alabama, it's Maxwell Air Force Base.
Yes.
It's Gunnerfield Air Force Base.
Right.
And we live not too far from the base. So my sister-in-law had met boyfriends, which was from Nigeria, and they was like sergeants and all them and captains and everything. They was from, and so I just fell right on in. My mama, you know, she had passed, and so my sister and them just partied and drank and all of that and stuff, and I thought it was so awful. And I started drinking, and I like the way it made me feel, but not the way it made me taste. You know,
yeah, you don't like the taste, but you like the way it made you feel.
Made me feel, and made me just like to, you know, forget and stuff. So I just, and I drank, and I stayed down there, and until they was sent off away, and that's how I know I'm coming to alcoholism, because when they were stationed went somewhere else, and the liquor store down there, it didn't, what they call the state store.
Right.
It didn't open up until 12 o'clock. So, well, you're looking for me. But I found me a bootlegger.
A bootlegger?
A bootlegger.
Yeah.
So I found, you know what a bootlegger is?
Well, I want you to tell me, because I think
a bootlegger is when you sell liquor and you don't have a license to sell.
So you're selling it illegally without the state permit?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I found me a bootlegger. So I went there and I got the liquor. So I knew I was in trouble. So, but I knew anyone didn't want to admit it. So, and then I started just having the shakes, the trembles. So, while I was down there, I also got sick. My grandmother had a store down there, you know, the candy store, the grocery store. And I got sick with tuberculosis. And first I was sick with, I had some up in my rectum, I guess it was cancer. They would tell me, the doctor said, after they operated, it didn't be there in 5 years. But I was down to, this was after I had married the other husband, second husband.
Yes.
And I came back in 75.
Right.
And all of this happened, 75, 78.